All right, we are going to talk about topic one, section three, geometric sequences and series. I like geometric sequences because those are the ones you see most often in the real world. You can see them in fossils, you can see them in ruins, and there's a connection between that and geometric sequences, and that is carbon dating. Okay, that's an example of a geometric sequence. A process called half-life. Anyway, we'll get to all this and we'll apply it, but geometric sequences really play a big factor in the real world. So let's talk about the formula for a geometric sequence. You will be given the formula, but I also like to know how it's rooted. You know, a sequence can be, let's see, 3, 6, 12, 24. All right, and you can see here what we're doing every single time is we're multiplying by 2. All right, well, we can rewrite each one of these terms. All right, this 3 can be written as 3 times 1. 6 can be written as 3 times 2. 12 can be written as 3 times 2 times 2. 24, 3 times 2 times 2 times 2. All right, so another way is writing these as exponents. All right, so here we can write this as 3. Well, actually, we'll come back to that first one. This one's a little easier. 3 times 2 to the first. This one is 3 times 2 squared. This one is 3 times 2 cubed. Oh, I accidentally erased that one. All right, this one, you can write this one the same way as 3 times 2. It would be 2 to the 0. All right, now, if we remember our term numbers, this was our first term, this was our second term, third term, fourth term. So what about our nth term? What would that be? All right. Well, there's a relationship between the term and the exponent. Okay, hopefully you're realizing that it's just one less than the term. So here, our formula is just that simple. It's 3 times 2 to the n minus 1. Think about what those numbers mean. 3 was our first term. 2 was our ratio, what we were multiplying every single time. And then our exponent is just n minus 1. That's how you find the nth term of a geometric sequence. I just think it's kind of fun that you're able, this one, I'm not always able to derive an equation easily and fast, or I'm sorry, a theorem for you guys. I know you guys like proofs, or some of you do. This one, I like it because it just wraps it up really nice. It's really easy to follow. All right, so let's look at these geometric sequences and let's look at these sequences and see if they are geometric, and let's find that common ratio. Okay, what are we multiplying every single time? All right, so the first one, let's see, we've got negative 2, 6, negative 18, 54. So we could sit here and logic it out, okay? Or we can, kind of think of like a specific term or specific way to find it. So like here, let me write it out. Here we have negative 2 times 3. Then that gets us 6. 6 times 3 is negative 18. Negative 18 times 3, where I was going with that, or that, would get you 54. Right? So you know you're multiplying by that r every single time. So we know we get the first term multiplied by r gets us the second term. So if we want to figure out what r is, we can just take the second term and divide by the first. Right? Basic algebra there. Okay? If you don't understand, just ask me in class. So here, we can figure that out by doing 6 divided by negative 2. So 6 divided by negative 2 is negative 3. And then here we have the next term, negative 18 divided by the 1 in front of that, 6. Well, look at that. It's negative 3. Then try the 1 after that, 54 divided by the 1 in front of that, negative 18. Well, look, we get negative 3. So even before, when I was just saying times 3, I was just looking at the numbers. I totally missed the negative sign. Anybody else miss that too? All right. So here, doing it this way, okay, helps get you those signs, and so you don't mess anything up. And notice that since it's all the same, all right, we have a geometric ratio. Okay. So that was A. I'm going to clear this out and do the next one. Okay. So now we're going to do B. There we go. All right, so we do it the same way. To get R, we take the second term and divide it by the first. All right, so here we get 2. Well, we can also take 8 and divide it by the 1 in front of that. Well, that gives us 4. These are different. So, this is not a geometric ratio. So this one would be a no. Did not write the answer out for you guys. Just so you know, for the last one, A is yes, it's a geometric ratio, and R was negative 3. Alright, let's keep going. Let's do C. Do the same thing. R would be 3 over 4 divided by 3. Hopefully you know that's the same thing as saying 3 over 4 times 1 over 3. That just gets us 1/4. Do it again. 3 over 16 divided by 3 over 4. That's just 3 over 16 times 4 over 3. We change 4. Okay, if these cancel out, we get 4 over 16. That's beautiful, because we end up with the same thing. We can also check it another way. Once we get our R, we can take that term and multiply it. So is 3 over 16 times 1 over 4 going to get us 3 over 64? Yep, sure is. So C, the answer is yes, and the R would be 1/4. Okay, that's the answer for C. Okay, another color. Alright, let's do D. Okay, if you're unsure, we can always just divide. So to get R, we're going to do 5x^4 over 5x². Hopefully you remember, we can just cancel out those x's and those 5's, and we end up with x². We keep multiplying. So 5x² times x². x². Yep, that's going to get us 5x^6. Is 5x^6 times x² going to get us 5x^8? It sure is. So here, the part D is another yes, and the R is x². Okay, so again, you don't need to memorize that formula. It's in your book. Okay, that's just one way to do it. Next one. So a geometric sequence has a term of 81 and a fourth term of 3. Find the common ratio and expression for the general term. So the term is first term times the ratio to the 1/-1. So it has a first term of 81. Perfect. That means I know it's going to equal 81. And a fourth term of 3. So the fourth term, the term is actually going to be 3, and the n, where it is in line, is the 4. And we don't know what r is, right? Because that's what we're looking for, the common ratio. So, we can work this out. We get 3 equals 81 times r cubed. I'd get rid of that 81, so we have 3 over 81 equals r cubed. That's just 1 over 4. 0.7, and we take the cube root of that, and we get 1/3. Alright, so the common ratio is 1/3, and then to find the general term, so the nth term, that would just be the first term, 3/1 times 3 to the n minus 1. Do not multiply 81 and 3, just like that. Alright, show that a sequence with 3 consecutive terms is geometric. Well, how we prove that it's geometric is if the ratio is all the same. So, do we have 375 divided by 75? That ends up being 2.5. I tend to do it a couple times in my head. Alright, then we check it again. We do 1875 divided by 375. Goodness, yeah, I'm going to check this one. Okay, so 1875, yep, we sure get so, the ratio. Sequence has a second term of 30 and a fifth term of blah blah blah. Find the common ratio, first term and general term. So we have a first term, second term is 30. 3, 4, 5. Fifth term of -4, 6, 8, 7, 5. Find the common ratio, first term and general term. So this is where I kind of cheat and do what I did in the arithmetic step. This is when I relabel this, just temporarily, as this is now my first term, and this is now my fourth term. Right? And if you count the two, you want to subtract one plus one. So, we have our fourth term. So, our formula. And we plug in what we have. We know the first term is 30, the last term here is -468.75. We don't know what r is, but that was the fourth term, so this is 4 minus 1. So, we do 468.75 divided by 30, and we get -15.625. Then we're going to take the cube root of that, and we should get -2.5. There's our r. And we can check it by multiplying by the terms. So 30 times 2.5. Okay, so that's going to be 75. Multiply it again by 2.5. That's going to be 187.5. Multiply it again by 2.5. Notice we get 468.75. What did I do? I got my numbers. So, we can go a little shortcut here. We can want to go backwards. So instead of multiplying, we just divide. Right? So, 30 divided by -2.5 should give us our term. Our first term, which is -12. So our first term, so our common ratio ended up being -2.5. Our first term is -12. And our general term is -12. I would put parentheses just because I don't know. Alright, times what's our ratio? -2.5 to the n minus 1. That's all you gotta do. Alright, geometric sequence has a second term of 14 and a sixth term of 224. This is done the exact same way as the last one. But yeah, I'll walk you through it again because I know this. this one has put people up in the past, so I'll just do it again. So we have a second term of 14, and we have a sixth term of 224. I relabel them, and I know there are 6 minus 2 plus 1 terms. Okay, we do 6 minus 2, yep, that's what you guys have been doing, but you're always one less, because you cut that one out, so you got to add that back. So there are 5 terms. Okay, so now this one's called my first term, and this one's now my fifth term. So, our fifth term, is 224. Our first term is 14. We don't know what R is, but N is 5 because that's the fifth term. So, 224 divided by 14 is 16. And that's R to the fourth. Alright, hopefully we know that is 2. That's not the only one, right? Okay. It could also be -2, right? Even exponents. Whenever you take an even root, you put the even root there. And when you put the even root there, you have to put plus or minus. So we have 2 options here. Okay? Notice how that's going to work out here. Alright? I find it easier if we can visualize. So, 4... 14 times 2 is 28. 28 times 2 is 56. Times 2 is 112. Times 2 is 224. But if we had done it as a negative, positive times a negative makes it negative 28. Makes it positive 56. Makes it negative 112. Makes it positive 224. Now it also works on both sides. Ooh, I'm so glad we did this one. Alright? So, it could be plus or minus. Okay? Could the 56 be negative? No. Okay? What about the one in front of it? Alright? So, we divide. So, 14 divided by 2 is going to be 7. But could that have been negative? Yes. But 14 would have to be positive. So, possible values, okay, of the common ratio are going to be positive 2 or negative 2, and the first term is going to be positive or negative 7. Alright? Very important that we do that. Alright, so the general term of the sequence is given by blah blah blah. Determine whether or not this is a geometric sequence. Okay, so why don't we plug stuff in? Right? First thing to do is look at the sequence. So the first term would be 5 to the 3 minus 4. So 5 to the negative 1. The second term is going to be 5 to the 3 minus 8. So 5 to the negative 5. The third term is going to be 5 to the 3 minus 12. Which is 5 to negative 9. Okay. Well, we're hopefully starting to see a pattern. If you're unsure, just keep on going. We get 5 to the 3 minus 16, and we get 5 to the negative 13. Okay. So hopefully you're realizing the exponents are increasing by 4. But is that geometric if we're adding 4 to the exponents? Yes, it is. Okay, it's because what we can do is we can write it as 5 to the negative 1 times 5 to the negative 4. What happens when you multiply? You add. Right? And that's what's happening. Then we could have tested it. 5 to the negative 5 over 5 to the negative 1 is just 5 to the negative 4. Right? Second term divided by the first term. The next term. this, find the possible values of x. Okay, so we know it's geometric. So, let's see, we know that x plus 2 over x minus 1 is the same thing as 3x over x plus 2. Okay, so why is that true? Because that's how we get our ratio. We take the second term and divide it by the first term. We take the third term divided by the second term. Okay, exactly what we did here. So now we have a fraction of a fraction, so hopefully we know that we can cross multiply. X plus 2 times x plus 2 is going to equal 3x. So we can square that. We get x squared plus 2x plus 2x plus 4 equals 3x squared minus 3x. So we get x squared plus 4x plus 4. I'm going to move, let's see, because this number is bigger, I'm going to move everything to the other side. So I'm going to go 0 equals, it's 2x squared, then I'm going to subtract 4x, then I'm going to get 7x, and then subtract 4. Okay, so let's see, this can factor, I'm assuming, because it's a quadratic, and easier to make this, right? So, let's see, 4, 1, 2, -1. There we go. And we can solve this. We get 2x plus 0. If you forgot how to factor, you can use the quadratic formula. It's got a bit different. So then this one ends up being -1/2. And this one ends up being -4. Alright, so we have 2x values. So, find the possible values of x. Okay, so that's all we're asked for. We're going to ask for the sequence, which asks for what the values of x would be. So we have 2x. So we'll find that. And you can check them by plugging them in there. Okay. Alright, so a geometric series is one that we're going to. Obviously, a geometric sequence, and we're going to add them all up. Okay? So, both formula are going to be on the sum of the first two terms, is going to be on your example. Okay? So, find the sum of the first 8 terms of the geometric sequence defined by this. Okay? So, the sum of the first 8 terms. We gotta think about what we need for our equations. Alright, looks like I have the first term here, I have ratio here, n is how many terms it is. That's all I need. Well, look at this formula. This is the geometric sequence formula. Okay, so let's just find the first term. So, to find the first term, we just plug in 1 for n, right? 24 over 5 times -5 over 2 to the first half. Alright, so that's nice, it's going to simplify. So our first term is just -12. Okay. We don't know what our ratio is. We can find our second term and go from there. So we plug in 2, and that's 24 over 5 times -5 over 2. That's going to be squared, so I'm just going to write it twice. So I'm going to have 5 that I cancel, my negative that I cancel, and then 2 that I cancel with this. I get 6 times 5. So this is going to be 30. Okay. Now since it didn't come out nice, I'm going to get a little nervous. I'm always with the third term just to make sure. Okay? So let's see. Okay. 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, negative 5 over 0. And that is what happens when you multiply negative 12 times negative 5 over 0, negative 30, times 30 times negative 5 over 0, you get all right, so you want to find the sum of the first 8 terms. Now I could keep going, but I really don't want to do 5 more terms. Okay, that was it. So let's find the sum of the first 8 terms. We need the first term, which was negative 12, times the ratio, which was negative 5 over 2, to the n, so the 8, minus 1, in your parentheses, all over negative 5 over 2, minus 1. You are more than welcome to change negative 5 over 2 to a decimal, because it does come out nice in this case, but not always. This is half a good number. So, sorry, I'm trying to plug it into my calculator and it's taking a little while. Divided by minus 1, so let's see. Okay, sorry, I got a really gross number and I wanted to double check it. Yes, so you're going to get something really gross when you plug this into your calculator. You should get 52,312.496. Alright, for example, let's say 2 rounds. If you have 4 rounds, you're going to do 2 3 significant figures. So this would be 5, 2, 3, and then we're done. We have 3 important numbers, everything else becomes a 0. Okay, we don't have to put and follow the book. Okay, there we have it. Alright, find the sum of the first 10 times of a geometric sequence is 1,364, and 2 consecutive terms are 32 and negative 64. Alright, well if they're consecutive terms, that tells you what the ratio is. Right? So that's wonderful, that tells you the ratio is negative 2. So calculate the value of the first term. So we know the sum of the first 10 terms. We remember our sum formula. I just realized I did that the other way. I like the other one better because it doesn't students tend to mess up here with this negative in front of the exponent. So I'm going to fix this. So we're going to do the first term and then call it the exponent over. Yeah. Alright, so the sum of the first 10 terms. We know that the sum of the first is 1364. We don't know what the first term is. We want to figure that out. We know r is negative 2. And we know n is 10. We work this out, this negative 2 minus 1 is negative 3, so I'm going to go ahead and multiply 1364 times negative 3, and we get negative 4,092 equals our first term, times negative 2 to the 10th minus 1. We don't know what negative 2 to the 10th would be, right? So it's going to be 1024. 1024 minus 1 is 1023. So we can divide that 412 by 1023, and we get negative 4 as our first term. Alright? So, application. This population growth or decline. So, when a population grows by a fixed percentage, it can be modeled using a geometric sequence. If you start with a population of people that grows 12% each year, and after 1 year, the population will be 112% of the original. That's much easier for us. So we can write it like this. Okay. It's 100% is your taking 100, you want all of what you had before, and then 12% more. Think of it like that. Okay. You don't want to lose that population. You want 100% plus 12% more. After 2 years, the population will be 112% of the population in the previous year. So it's going to be something like this. When you continue this pattern, you will see that it follows the pattern of a geometric progression with a ratio of 1.22. Okay, so how would you need to modify this instead of going 12% increase to 12% decrease? Okay, I originally have 100%. And if I'm decreasing by 12, I'm taking 12% away. So I want 88% of my original. That's how you do it to con. You subtract it from 100%. Increase, you add it to 100%. Okay? Alright. So the population of the city is blah 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 at the end of 2019. Find the population at the end of 2021 if it is decreasing by 5% each year. Okay, so why do I have a hint here? Why do I have this over here? Okay? Something different about this one. What is confusing us up here? Probably that decreasing. Yep. Big old thing I just mentioned last slide. Alright. We need to understand that it's decreasing by 5%. So, what we want to do is we want to take that original amount and we want to take 100% less than that. So, 100%, 5% less than the 100%. So we want to take 95%. So this is 100% minus our 5%. So really we're just multiplying this by 0.95. Okay? So, let's see. Calculator, 3 years. And this one's really hard. Gets us 3, 2, 8, 8, 2, 0, 0. And then we have to do it again times 0.95 to get the population in 2021. Okay, so we get 3,119,040. Okay, that's what it is in 2021. Okay? So, at the start of this of an experiment, there are two to do in sound bursts and state park. And so, the population of this bursts grows by 4% a year. Use the appropriate models to predict how many bursts will be in the park after 8 years. Okay, so, let's think about this. Okay, we know we're going to take 251 bursts, and every year it's going to increase by 4%, so it's going to go up 1.04, and we're going to multiply that by however many years we need. Okay? So I do this for every year I have, and this one we're doing for 8 years. So we're going to do 251 times 1.04 to the power. Alright, so I got my calculator, and I got 343.511, if you rounded. Okay, so what would you say for how many bears would be in the park after 8 years? Is this what you would give me? I hope not. I really don't want to find half a bear flying around. Okay, not make me very comfortable. Alright, so hopefully you say 343 bears is how many I could get that through in the mix. So now use the number to predict how many birds will be in the park after 100 years. Okay. So again, does it make sense why we didn't do the n minus 1 here? Okay. Because we want to do it the first year we want to multiply by 1.04. Okay. Alright, so let's do for 10. Okay, so we're going to have 251 times 1.04 to the 10th. Oh. That's 100 years? Okay. going to be calculated. Okay, so that I got 371.54. This, of course, I'm not going to say. I would forget 371 votes. Okay. Alright, the half-life of carbon-14 is 5,700 years. This is how long it takes to have the amount of carbon-14 present in a sample to decay. A sample initially contains 127 grams of carbon-14. Calculate how much carbon-14 remains in a sample after that many years. Okay? So, let's see. What this means is every year it's... words trip me up sometimes, so just give me a second. Half-life. What that means is that after 5,700 years, half of what was there is gone. Okay, like it decays, it withers away. Okay, so in 22,800 years, right, I'm going to divide it by 5,700. And I believe, yeah, that gives us 4, which means this sample we have of carbon-14 is going to go through 4 half-life cycles, where it's going to lose half of its life because it's been that long. Okay? So, we're initially starting with 127 grams, and its half-life, so half of it's disappearing. You can think of it as taking 50% or literally half, so 0.5 or 1/2. And then we're doing that 1/2 4 times. Okay? That's how we're going to find out what's left. Okay? So, let's see. 0.5 to the 4th power times 127. And we're left with 7.9375. Okay, that's what's left after 22,800 years. Okay? That's still kind of impressive in my opinion. You know, I know it was 127 grams, but that's not, grams is not a lot. Okay? Anyway. So, let's see, next one. Would you guys read that? For this one, you really want to make sure that you can utilize your calculator, and you don't want to round anywhere in your equation and your solving techniques. You want to wait till the very last minute to round. Okay, and if you have to round, you put a lot of decimals in there. Okay, before you get to the end. Okay, so calculate the annual salary for a working company for after 7 years. So you start with 45,000. And you increase by 5% after each year. So 1.05 increase, and you're going to increase 7 times. Okay? So give your answer to the correct nearest pound. So 1.05 to the 7th on your calculator. Every calculator is different. And then times 45, and I get 63,319. To the nearest pound. Okay? That's not the nearest pound. I'm going to back it up. It would be, technically, it's 319.5, but since we want the nearest pound, we're going to make that 63,320 pounds. Okay? You don't need the comma there, but you can do that. So, calculate the total amount of money earned by an employee if they work at the company for 70 years. Oh, I'm sorry. This was the annual salary. Now we want to calculate the total amount of money earned by an employee if they work at the company for 7 years. So this is every year added up. Okay? So, we want to find the sum of the first 7 terms of the sequence. The first one is 45,000. Then we do 1 minus, nope, other way around. Okay, we'll do R n minus 1. What am I doing? We can just go ahead and plug that stuff in. R would be 1.05 to the 7th. You want to find 7 terms. Minus 1 all over 1.05 minus 1. Okay, so you want to work that one out. Alright, that answer should be 3663 90. Okay. Now, so determine whether it gets a hint, we need to do those two things. Alright, to determine whether working would earn more money if it's left the job for 7 years or for another job that pays $50,000 and increases annually by 2%. Okay, so now you're going to do the same thing, right? But try the same equation, but now for $50,000 with an annual increase by 2%. Alright, you work that one out. So 371714. So just a little bit more. So this part, this other job, would be the better one. Okay? Second salary on the electric engineer is $61,000. Fifth salary on this is $78,000. Find the number of complete years that must pass before the engineer salary equals $78,000. So, we know that they start at 61,000. Okay, so find the number of complete years that must pass before the engineer's salary equals 70,000. Okay, so that's the term. I'm taking there at the sum. So this is what that year of the salary. So that would be the nth term. So if you remember this formula that is, this would be 78,000 is what we're trying to reach. The original is 61,000. The rate would be 1.037. And then it increases every year. And we don't know how many years that's going to be. Okay. So first thing I would do is I would get rid of the 61,000. So I would have 78,000 divided by 61,000. That's something like this. It's only a 78.61 for the minute. So hopefully you're looking at this and you're like, that's an exponent and I don't like it the way it's written. Maybe I should put it into log form, right? 1.037 to the n power equals this number, right? Something gross. Put that into log form. That would be log base 1.037 times 78.61 plus minus. Log base 1.037 of 78.61 equals n. So you can plug that into your calculator. You can either change the base formula, so log of this divided by log of this. Right? And your graphing calculator should be able to do the change of base, depending on the. Alright, so using the calculator, you should get 6.766366, yada yada yada. Alright, but remember what n is. N represents which term, right? And in this case, which year it is. So after 6.7 years, they'll make that. But that's not what they're asking. Find the number of complete years. So, he's not going to make it in 6 years. So we have to round up in this case, and it would be 7 years. Okay? Alright, so this one is everything you need to know about geometric sequences in series. If you have any questions, feel free to ask. See ya!